Before the world began, it was a Hallelujah, let's give God some praise this morning. Hallelujah, let's lift up our voices. The voice of triumph. Hallelujah, the voice of victory in this place. Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. We lift up your name, Jesus. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. With a shout of victory in this place. Hallelujah. With a voice of triumph all over this place. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. Oh, we thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. Oh, come on. Come on, church. We can get better than that. We can get better than that. It's the first time this building's opening up in a while. The church should not stop, but the building is opening up. Let's worship together. Let's lift up our voices. Let's lift up our praises to Jesus. We thank you, Lord. Holy Spirit, continue to move in this place. Though I walk through the valleys of the shadows of death, I will fear no evil. Hallelujah, says the word. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for the day that you have made. So we will be glad and rejoice in it, Lord. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. We love you, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Good morning, good morning. Hallelujah. Woo! How many feel the Spirit in this place right now? The Spirit in this is in this place with us this morning. The Bible says where two or three are gathered, He is there in the midst. Amen. He's close. We know we can't be really close to each other giving hugs, but He's right next to you. He's right there holding you tight. Because the Bible says in Psalms 23, though I walk through the valleys of the shadows of death, people, I will fear no evil, though He is with me. Though He is with me. Amen. That's enough for us to walk with no fear, be able to do the things that we're going through. Amen. Just to be able to stand right here, just to be able to do these things. This is an awesome, awesome time. We just want to take a moment and say Happy Mother's Day to every mother that's here with us this morning. You know, it's an awesome thing. We thank you so much. Thank you for everything you do. Thank you for things that, you know, just being awesome superheroes. Amen. Amen. But there's a word in Psalm in Isaiah 26:3 that I read, and it's so awesome. It's so awesome. And it says this. Isaiah 26:3, it says, "You will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you, because he trusts in you. For Yah, the Lord, is everlasting strength." And this whole week, my scripture has been, though I walk through the valleys of the shadows of death. Yeah, that's been my scripture this week. But that one, when that one added to it, man, I will trust in him no matter the things that we might be going through. And during this week, I did a little study on a tornado. You know, on a tornado, when it's going fast, it can tear up everything around you. It's tearing up the whole thing. It's an ugly picture of a tornado. But everything around it is being torn up. And right in the dead center, in the eye of the storm, there are scientists that say that's one of the most beautiful pictures that you can ever be in. Right in the middle of it. And I was just thinking, man, can we just imagine the picture that we're in when everything around us might look like it might be getting tore up, destroyed. But we know when we're standing in the center and we're standing on our foundation of the God's word, we can look around and say, man, no matter where I'm walking through, no matter the valley that I might be in, no matter where I'm at, the Bible says that no weapon that is formed against you, against me, shall prosper. So for us to be able to take that word and take it, and not just drag it along, no, but carry it as your shield, your full armor of God, and be able to walk it. No wind, no nothing in this world can take you down because you're standing and you're rooted in the word of God. Amen. Amen. So with that being said, let's lift up all of our needs all over this place. All over this place. We all have our needs. But we know that God is still the same yesterday, today, and forever. Just like the song was talking about. The God that we serve, He's still with us. So we're going to take every need that's in this place. We're going to lift up our, we're going to lift them up, and we're going to give them up to God. Because today's service is going to be powerful. It's going to be chains are being going to be broken. Amen. This is just the beginning. This is just the beginning. Oh, amen, 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 amen. Let's go. Let's go. Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you for what you're going to be doing in this place. Thank you for all the chains that are going to be broken. Thank you for the lost souls that are going to be coming to you, Lord God. We pray that everybody that walks into this place walks out differently, Lord. We thank you for what you're going to be doing. Thank you for your word. We thank you for the Son of God, Jesus Christ, as our Lord and Savior. We love you for what you're going to be doing. We pray for all the needs that are in this place, Lord God, from the top of their heads to the soles of their feet. Lord, the Bible says that by your stripes we are healed. So anybody with physical pain, any kind of pain, to be removed right now as far as the east is from the west. Lord God, we know that the Bible says that greater is he that is in me than he that is in this world. So nothing will come against us because you are with us, Lord God. We love you. We thank you. Continue to take us and let us arrest our minds and our hearts and let us focus on your word this morning. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Glory to God. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise this morning. Amen. Come on, put your hands together like you need it this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Praise God. You may be seated this morning. Our ushers are preparing. We're going to receive an offering this morning. How many are excited to be able to give to God this morning? Amen. I tell you, it's one thing to be able to give from home and by text, and that's all wonderful. But there is nothing like, and I love what Pastor Andrew says a lot. He says, there's nothing greater than to be able to hold up that offering and just be able to drop it in that basket. Amen. And I find great joy in that myself. Not to be lifted up myself, but I want to glorify God. Amen. I want to bless him. Amen. I want God to be pleased with me. Amen. How many know what the Bible does expect us to be givers? Amen.
Amen.
And, you know, God has big plans for us. And I'm thinking about all that's going on as our ushers go ahead and prepare to come down. I will just say this, as we receive the offering this morning, we're going to ask that our ushers are going to walk in the empty aisle that is in front of you, and they're going to hold the basket, and they're going to just hold it, and you put your offering in if you have one this morning. And we're going to ask that you don't touch the plate. We're just doing this to be extra cautious. As our government has asked us to do these things, we are following all the rules. If you've seen signs up at the doors or tables with gels and hand sanitizers, there's a reason for all that, amen. We're trying to comply to all the rules and regulations that have been given to us, and our pastor has put a lot of work into this, and I'll tell you what, if we would just obey, we're going to be all right, amen? So let's do that. Let's not be offended. Let's just be a part of what we're doing here, and if somebody asks you to move or someone asks you to do something, just be glad to do it, amen? Put a smile on your face and just say, God bless you, hallelujah. You have no idea how hard it is for some of us to come in this place and not be able to hug, amen? I tell you, some of you are just real happy that you don't get hugged, amen? But glory to God, one day it's going to be over with, amen? Hallelujah. I love the torment. You know, I was thinking about all that's going on in this world today and all the ups and downs in our lives and all the things that we've been through. If you just take a moment to think about what you've been through in your life. And, you know, today is Mother's Day, and it's a wonderful time to worship and praise God for our mothers and just thank God for them. They're powerful. They're amazing. My mother, I would not be here today if it was not for my mother. Amen. What she's done for me, and I don't mean just be here because of my mother. I'm talking about her prayers and all that she's done for me, amen? But I'm thinking about the trials and the tribulations that we're going through in our lives, every single person. And our finances. I listened to a lot of Dave Ramsey. I love to listen to money things that are business-oriented. I love to listen to, I don't listen to garbage. I only listen to good stuff, amen? Stuff that feeds my soul. And I was listening to a family that you know, they were so excited. They were able to yell out, I'm debt-free. And, you know, they were able to do that. But they get back on the radio months later, and they're asking Mr. Ramsey what he thought about them going out and getting a loan to buy a new car. And I got to thinking about that. You know, sometimes we get out of debt. Sometimes we get out of a situation. But somehow we crawl right back into our same problem that we just came out of. Amen. And sometimes it feels like you're on a roller coaster that just never stops. Amen. You ever? I know some of you just wish the roller coaster would never stop. But when I ever got on a roller coaster, I was waiting for the moment that the roller coaster stopped so I can get off. Amen. Therefore, I don't get on them anymore. Hallelujah. Not even a Ferris wheel will you ever see me on. But I got to thinking about this, and I was thinking about this, and I've shared this before here, but you know, I was thinking about this young lady. She was this blonde woman. She decides to try horseback riding for the first time, and I'm trying to relate this to how you and I are in our finances at times. You know, sometimes we are up, and then another time we're down. Another time we're blessed, and another time we're cursed. And you know, the Bible does talk about the blessing and the curse in our finances, amen? Not just finances, but in our life. But here's this woman, she wants to try this horseback riding, and even though she has had no lessons or prior experience, she mounts the horse unassisted, and the horse immediately springs into action. You can imagine, this horse just just going to town. And as it gallops along at a steady and rhythmic pace, this blonde lady begins to slip from the saddle. And in terror, she grabs for the horse's mane, but cannot get a firm grip on the mane. She tries to throw her arms around the horse's neck, but she slides down the side of the horse anyways. The horse gallops along and seemingly impervious to its slippery rider. Finally, losing her frail grip, this blonde lady attempts to leap away from the horse and throw herself to safety. Unfortunately, her foot becomes entangled in the stirrup, and she is now at the mercy of this horse's pounding hooves as her head is struck against the ground over and over and over. She's just beating the ground. And as her head is battered against the ground, and she is mere moments away from unconsciousness, to her great fortune, Mr. Frank, the Walmart greeter, sees her and unplugs the horse. Amen? Now, for those that didn't get it, she was at the, maybe just too young to understand the joke, amen? But back when I was young, they had those plug-in horses, and you can get on a little Ferris wheel or a little tiny merry-go-round or a little horse you can plug in and ride. But, you know, sometimes you and I in our finances, this is how we're living our life. We're getting beat up. We're holding on to this horse that is electronic. It's an electronic horse, and we're just riding it. Maybe it's a bull, and we're just holding on for dear life because we are not making wise decisions. I got news for you this morning. It is easy to serve God. I hear too many people in this world say, oh, it's so hard to serve God. I'm really struggling to serve God. It's difficult for me to serve God. I got news for you. That is a lie from the pit of hell. And it's not hard to give to God either, amen? Let me tell you something. There's no greater joy in this world but than to give to the Lord, amen? There's no greater joy, not just giving to God, but being obedient to His Word. And many times in our lives, and listen, I want to stir you up this morning. I want you to give more, give bigger, give greater than you ever have this morning. I want you to make a fresh commitment now as we're coming into the church again. And I want you to make a fresh commitment to say, you know what? Say, Lord, I am going to do more than I have ever done before. Now listen to me. You're not investing into a horse race. You're not investing into Kobe Bryant as a lot of people in this world have. And man, let me tell you something. One of the greatest players ever played a game. But too many people focus on the prize instead of focusing on who the prize really is. Because God is the prize, amen? Listen, we need to understand today that when we come into the house of God, we are coming to bless God. We're not coming in here just to say, oh, here I is, Lord. No, no, no. It ain't about us. It's about Him. And the Bible keeps it very simple for us to understand. As a matter of fact, it says in Matthew 6:33, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Let me tell you something. If we would just keep things in order with God in our lives, if we would continue to pray and just read the Word of God, that's an instruction book, guys. Let me tell you something. When we read the Word of God, it begins to read us. You say, well, I have a difficult time giving my tithe. Well, get into the Word of God. You open up this Word, and I'm going to tell you something. God will begin to speak to you. God will begin to deal with your heart. God will begin to say to you, you know what? There's a need over here. There's a need in the church. There's a need in one of these families over here. There's a need across town that's going on. Somebody may need to be lifted up. Someone may need to be encouraged. Amen? It all works together. But if we're not reading His Word, if we're not applying God's Word to our life, if we're not doing the things that we need to do, that means walking in righteousness and in truth. In Psalms chapter 1 through 3, talks about that. How we walk in righteousness, that means we walk in the ways that we need to be walking in. That straight and narrow path, when we say, you know what, God, I'm going to do this, and yes, I'm going to get rocks thrown at me. I'm going to hit a speed bump every once in a while, but Lord, I am going to go forward, and I am going to be blessed, because not just because I want more, but because I want to please God. Amen? How many want to please God in this place this morning? Come on, if you want to please God, lift your hand up. Put it up. Hallelujah. And I believe God, the rest of you are going to lift your hand up one day. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Let's ask God to bless this offering. Father, we just thank you, Lord, for this service that we're able to be in today, God. We thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in our lives. We thank you, Lord, for this wonderful church that we have, God. We ask you, Lord, to just bless this service today, Lord. Bless the gift. Bless the giver. Father God, help us to make great decisions, Lord. Help us to be wise and to follow your plan. not just your financial plan, but your spiritual plan for our lives, Father God. Lord, help us to commit this morning, not just in our giving and our faithfulness and our tithing today, God, but we ask, Lord, that in our personal walk with you, Father God, that you would give us strength. Help us, Lord, to be overcomers. Help us to defeat sin. Help us to take authority over the sins in our lives. And Lord, to stand strong on your word and believe it, God, to read that word. Lord, to listen to your voice as you speak to us, Father God. We thank you for what you're doing, and we give you all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' name. And all God's people shouted, amen. You
You didn't do it in your living rooms, probably. I can't imagine what you look like in your living rooms. You look like that here. Pajamas and asleep. Amen. It was so good to be back in the house. How many are glad to be back in the house? As much as we were creative and as much as we did what we did, it's nothing like being here, being together. Amen. So today's going to be an awesome day. Obviously, our attendance isn't going to be what it would normally be, but I think this is a pretty good turnout for the first service back. Amen. I'm going to show a video here in just a second. If you guys are getting ready, I'm going to switch that around. So just get that video ready. Because I don't want some people that have to go teach to miss it. It's so cute. Then we're going to have the moms come up in just a second. And we're going to honor them like we always do, pray over them, and give some gifts out. But I found this video yesterday, and I think it's one of the cutest things I've ever seen. So I'm going to play this real quick.
On behalf of all the kids in the world, here are two things every mom needs to know. Number one, put down your phone, unless your kid is named phone. Number two, don't name your kid phone. That's just not right. That's messed up. Number three, we love you. It's just sometimes we don't know how to say it. Sometimes it just comes out screaming or crying. But the next time your kid screams, you know what they're really saying is, I love you, Mom. You're beautiful. Thank you for not naming me phone. Four, stop cleaning. Our house isn't messy. Our house is awesome. It's awesome because we live in it. My mom got stuff to do. Number five, Mom upside down is wow. Doesn't really mean anything, but I just thought it was really cool. Wow. It should be like this. Wow, 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 wow. Number six, while I have you here, I want to take a second and talk about meatloaf. Meatloaf's like a loaf of bread, but meat on the meatloaf. Number seven, thank you for cleaning up all the poop. Number eight, have fun for lunch. We love to see you have fun. Dance in the grocery store. I found all this stuff. Or sing in the middle of the driveway. Oh, it'll feel great. And then it'll scare your kids so much, they'll be quiet. Number nine, hug more, shout less. Look, I get it. Sometimes we do some things wrong. But growing up is scary. There's school, there's tests, there's telling times with clocks that have hands, there's time with shoes, and kilograms and kilometers.
Kilometers?
I don't know, it's hard, but that's why I go to school. It's just hard to grow up. Sometimes we just need moms to tell us everything's okay. Number 10, the secret to changing the world, moms. Without moms, none of us will be here. Moms, kids love you, and you. If every mom in the world knew how awesome they were, every problem in the world would be fixed. from kids everywhere. Thanks for believing in us, putting up with us, and straight up loving us. Mom, you keep us dancing.
That doesn't make your day. I don't know what's wrong. Amen. Moms, would you stand this morning and come forward so we can honor you and clap for you and pray for you and bless you this morning? All the moms, just stand and come forward, please, and stay spread out up here. Stay distanced. Amen. As they're coming, those that are not moms can begin to do what you're supposed to do already. Stay spread out, moms. Yeah, get them hands. Today we're not going to have as much of a problem as usual. Sometimes it's all the way across, shoulder to shoulder. Making the kids do it. That's right. This is what we're making the kids do back in the Sunday school area. We got a new one over there. All right. Ushers that are going to help you with the prizes, if you come forward and get those ready. So we're going to do this different. Normally we would do it. We're going to pray over you in a minute and bless you and thank you, amen, for all that you do. I can't add anything to what Kid President said. He did a great job. But we're going to do it different. Normally, if you might have noticed, maybe you came in and you're like, where's my raffle ticket at? Because you've been coming here for a long time. So you might have thought, we're not getting gifted. But you are. We're just not letting you touch the tickets. And we're not touching the tickets. We're trying to think of every way, not such stuff. Now, how many?
Mom's dream.
I know, yeah, right? Mom's dream. Not touch stuff. You don't have to touch anything today. I know. As Pastor Mario said, some people were already experts at social distancing. And they're very happy. But how many are like me? I do love to hug. But how many are like me and are glad that everything's cleaner? I'm praying that this continues forever, right? That we're so clean and we should be like this all the time, right? So thank God for the cleanliness. Who has more than three kids? Raise your hand. Leave it up.
Put it up.
Oh, that one. Yeah, I've got it. Okay, two over three. Who has four kids? Who has five kids? Uh-oh. Six? Okay, a tie. So you guys have to fight arm wrestle in the middle here. Just kidding. You guys both get a gift. Give a gift to both the moms who have the most children, okay? Who drove more than 10 miles this morning to get here? My wife doesn't want one. She don't count. Oh, here we go. Okay, we really have less questions this morning because we're trying to think of questions that only one person would get. Okay? So you guys already win. How many miles? Hey, you don't get a gift because you don't know. You're going to get another gift. How many miles? Men? Please tell me you know how far you drove.
60 miles.
Thank you. 60 miles. That's got me and Carla beat. Paul and Brenda beat. All right. Everybody's in the competition to move further away from church. Okay, so Julie and Bethany both get a prize. No, not Jennifer. She didn't know how far she lives. Who has the youngest baby? That is a special one for you. You gotta be in every single one of them. So, baby, how old?
6 weeks.
6 weeks. Awesome. All right, who has grandchildren? Let me see the grandparents. Okay, one, two, three, four grandmas. Who has at least three grandchildren? Of them, four. You have four. Okay, five. Six. Seven. Uh-oh, this better not be a tie. Eight. Nine. Ten. Okay, that's okay. You get it anyways, because she already won a prize for eight grandchildren. many have we given away? We've got to make sure we have that 10 for the second service. Somebody count with me. Now, you were going to win the next one anyways, and I'm not going to use that question, probably. Who was born in the farthest country from here?
Oh, maybe.
So she was maybe, right? Anybody born far besides this continent? So you see, you'd have won that one too. My cousin was born in Alemania, Germany. Like, that's not the country. How many have we got? Four left. Okay. All right. Ooh, I better not say that one. Let's see if I can say that one. Who has been attending VWO the longest? You've been attending for more than 5 years. Raise your hand. Six? Seven? Eight? Nine? 10? 11? 11. And then you got her by about a month.
Yeah.
So Laura wins for the one who's been coming the longest. If you don't know, Laura was at the very first service we ever had in our living room. Amen? That's pretty awesome. Three left, right? Okay. What? She would have won if she was her husband would have let her. She'd have been the first one. Even before we came back, she wanted to come. Okay, who is the youngest mom? If you are less than, I don't even know where to start. I might get in trouble. 25? Less than 25? Is that a good number? I don't know how old any of y'all are. No one's less than 25? Okay, less than 30. All right? We've got two right here, less than 30. 29. Less than 29. Less than 28. 27 or 26? One of those two, right? All right. Deanna gets it for the youngest mom. Two left, am I right? Two left? Okay. Who woke up the earliest this morning? You woke up before 6. Raise your hand. Priscilla wins. All right. Jennifer, you can get all kinds of prizes today. One left, right? Who has the most kids that has not won a prize? The most kids. If you have more than 3 kids, raise your hand. I did grandkids. We did kids? Oh, man. Oh, we have it twice on the list. You know why it's messed up? We're filming this morning so we can upload this, and all the questions are on my phone. So I was scrambling to try to remember questions. I don't think I have anything left. Somebody give a good question that would help me get this last prize away.
Married the longest.
There you go. Who's been married the longest out of who has not gotten a prize? Been married more than 5 years. Okay, I think Noemi, you want to? Okay, this is going to be an obvious one and a good one. Shout out how long you've been married, Aunt Vicki. 46 years. Amen. All right, so Aunt Vicki, this is the last prize. All right, we're going to pray over these ladies. I want to say, as my Aunt Vicki gets her prize, that they're going to be taking off tomorrow. They've been with us for several months. It's been a big blessing to have them right out here in the RV. And they're heading to eventually Florida, but first Missouri. And I want to thank them for all their help, and especially Uncle Robert, many days that he came over here and served in all kinds of ways with the sanctuary. And let's give them a hand for blessing us with all their help. Amen. And being great examples. I'm very blessed with a great heritage of godly people in my family. And I was telling my uncle yesterday or the day before how they've always been a couple I've looked up to. They've been solid ever since I was a kid. They've always been in church, always served, always been the same. They've never changed. So they're an amazing example. We're going to pray this morning. If you would all just stand, we'll pray a blessing over the moms this morning. And pray that this is a day where they feel honored and special and healthy and blessed, and all the desires of their heart will be given to them, and any pains or any sadness will be taken away. Amen. Father, we thank you this morning for these beautiful, precious mothers. that are so important to us. And Lord, this, they're the heartbeat of the church because they're servants and their spirits are so sweet and they're so willing to give. And we thank you, Lord, for the heart that you gave to a mom to serve and to be a part of the work of God. Lord, we pray for supernatural blessings over these moms this morning. We pray for health. We pray for prosperity. We pray for peace and joy. We pray, Lord, that every desire they have would be given to them. Lord, that you would bless their children and their grandchildren and their children's children's children, Father. You just continue to bless them over and over. And today they would be honored by their husbands, by their families. And they would know without a doubt this morning that they are special in your eyes and in our eyes. And we thank you for them this morning, God. And we give you the glory and the honor for them this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. As they go to sit down, let's give them all a big hand this morning of thanksgiving. Praise God. Amen. You can be seated this morning. Is that it? Is that everything? Is it time to preach? I forgot. We're trying to get back into this. I sent John up after the second song. And we were like, oops. He played it off good. And then me and him were both smiling for about 5 minutes, laughing. But we've been, you do realize today it's been 2 months since our last service? 2 months, which is crazy. Yes, it's crazy really how long it's been, but then at the same time how fast it was. It's always weird. Everything's going fast. So I hope that everybody noticed something different this morning.
Right.
I hope. Amen. If you didn't notice something different, you got to leave. Amen. Because we have been laboring. Amen. I want to thank Nestor, especially Frankie, for helping me paint the sanctuary. And then I want to give a special thanks to everybody that came and helped, but especially to Santos and his sons. They were a tremendous blessing to me. I mean, tremendous, honestly. Jerry and Veronica also came and helped, and they're not here this morning, but if they wouldn't have showed up, we couldn't have got this floor done in time. So it was just a godsend. One day I was heading up here, and everybody that I could think of was working, and some had even started their jobs back, and I was like, man, God, I need help. This was Thursday, I believe. No,
Tuesday.
And Monday, one thing was great was got the carpet in early. We were supposed to get the carpet Tuesday or Wednesday, and they called me Monday, and I wasn't even planning on coming in. I got that call, and I shot down here, and I got a head start, so we got a little bit put in Monday. But Tuesday, I'm on my way up here, and I'm like, Lord, if someone can come up here, just let them contact me. Literally within 5 minutes, Santos sent me a text and said, I'm heading to the church. And I was like, wow, amen. Isn't that amazing? Within 5 minutes. And was able to show the guys how to use the trowel and how to put the glue down. And there was an art form to it, amen, and how to figure out how to spread the glue. That glue was $135 a gallon. That's expensive, amen, or 4 gallons, sorry. And it took lots of glue to get this down, but it's been a labor of love. But I'm telling you, I'm so in love with it. It feels so clean in here. It feels bigger in here, amen. It's a humongous blessing. And I know by faith, when we bought it, and even more today, that God is going to provide and it's going to be taken care of. Amen. We're not asking for special pledges. We just, as I said last Sunday, let's just give like Pastor Marshall. Let's just be bigger givers than we've ever been. And God's going to provide. Amen. I want to take just a few minutes this morning to preach a quick message on how to honor your mother.
Amen.
I've never preached this message before. This will be a new one. How to honor your mother. Amen. Now, I'm not saying I'm perfect on this, but there's one thing I can tell you I do know and understand is I understand the concept of how to honor my mother. My mother has always been a humongous blessing. She will be in the second service this morning because I can't keep her home. And was she going to come in after? I have special instructions for them. And if you see my mother and you hug her, I will shoot you. Amen. Even though you want to hug her and she wants to be hugged. Amen. But she's going to come in after and leave before it's over. But she will not miss church.
Amen.
And so I'm so blessed by my mother, and I'm thankful that I have the opportunity to bless her. I'm so thankful for my baby's mama. My rib, amen, who is a fantastic mother, amen. I'm hoping maybe by next Mother's Day, I could have my daughter be a mother maybe. No, it's kind of her hoping for that. You know, that would be a great Mother's Day. No pressure, Landon. Amen. Hey, once it's done, I mean, you got to give into it, right? And then you got to start, you know, encouraging. Amen. I'm ready to be a grandpa. Did you know that the first official Mother's Day was 105 years ago? You know, if you think about that, that's kind of crazy because there's been mothers for 6,000 years. But some woman named Anna Garvis in Grafton, West Virginia, led and initiated a move in a St. Andrew's Episcopal Church 105 years ago to have the first Mother's Day. And that same year, it actually became a presidential proclamation, and it's been since that mothers would be celebrated in America. Then she continued that movement on and on, and now we know that it's celebrated all over the world. And lots of people celebrate it in May, but some countries celebrate it in different months. One of those that I know of very firsthand is Costa Rica, where my wife is from, and my wonderful mother-in-law, who I'm so thankful to have such a great mother-in-law, is in August. And many other countries celebrate different things. The interesting thing about Anna Garvis is that she started Mother's Day, and you might think she would start Mother's Day because she might have felt unappreciated, or, you know, how come no one gives us moms clout or gives us honor? But Anna Garvis was never married and never had children. She was the one who started Mother's Day. So she had a desire to honor her own mother. Mother's Day is the third highest day of the year for giving out cards. 150 million cards will be given today to mothers. And it's the second largest gift day, only surpassed by what? Christmas. So if you want to look in your Bibles or look on the screen, I have one verse this morning, or one set of verses, and the rest is going to be some homework for us. Ephesians chapter 6, 1 to 3 says this. Children, how many children do I have in here this morning? You guys need some coffee? How many children do I have in here this morning? If you're watching online, there are some people who aren't raising their hand, and so we have some aliens in the house today. I believe we are all children, right? Okay. Some of us have not been children for so long that we forgot. Obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother. And this is a powerful thing because it says this is the first commandment with a promise. There's a promise that goes along. It says that it may be well with you and that you may live long on the earth. How many know that's a good promise? So the Bible says, Old Testament and New Testament, that if you want to have a long life, that you need to honor your mother and father. Today's Mother's Day, honor your mother. And it says it will go well with you and you will live long on the earth. Now, if I'm looking for extra reactions today from you, don't get mad at me. I've been preaching to nobody for 2 months. I'm super excited to see faces and get laughs. Amen? So I'm a little needy this morning. 8 things that you can do to honor your mother. I'll go fast. Don't worry. It sounds like a lot. Give me 3. 8 things you can do to honor your mother. These are all things that all of us can work on. And they would all be found, I don't want to give scriptures for everyone, they'd all be found in the Bible. But like I said, this is homework. Number one. Now, before I read these, it's not a question of, is my mom worthy, or is my mom good enough, or does she deserve it, or any of those things. That's not in the Bible, that we're to honor our mother if she's a great mother. Amen. Although I do believe most of us have great moms, and I do understand, as always, that some don't have great relationships with their parents or whatever, but the Bible didn't ask us. He told us. It's a commandment, that thing said, right? This is the first commandment with a promise that we're to honor. Your mom might be in heaven. Your mom might be in eternity this morning, and so you can't honor her, but you can honor the mothers around you in this way. The first one is to love her unconditionally, no matter what. To love your mom unconditionally, no matter what. Not when she's lovable or if I feel like loving her, but that's something we should all do to honor our mother, is to love her unconditionally, no matter what. You know, no matter how good or bad your mom was, your mom loved you unconditionally. She brought you into this world. Amen? Number two. And this is a little bit harder right now, especially for me. Show her affection often. Show her affection often. Now, if you're not the touchy person, huggy person, whatever, that's fine. Affection can be in many different ways. It could be in words. It could be in different things. But we need to show affection. I was thinking about this and how important a mom is. And all of us that were children, you might remember, depending on no matter how your mom and dad's relationship was, you can remember the times when, as a kid, you said something to your mom in front of your dad that was disrespectful. I know nobody else besides me ever did that. But how many know that's the moment a lot of times when you get the backhand? Right? I can remember many times where it wasn't always me, but one of us would be in the back. There was three of us. And a word of disrespect was spoken to my mama, and the hand came back and got all of us. Boom, 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 boom. He didn't care who said it or who disrespected it. He said, "That's my wife. You're not going to talk to my wife like that." Did that happen to anybody else? Anybody else ever get a backhand or a front hand or any kind of hand for disrespecting? So affection is very important. Now I have a thought this morning before I go on to number three. I'm not going to spend a lot of time between all these, but there is a story that is one of the funniest stories that I've ever heard in my life, and it was told by Steve Harvey. Now I'm not going to cuss, okay, in this joke or in this story, because anybody that knows Steve Harvey knows that he was a comedian before he was this TV guy. And I don't know him or anything. Supposedly he got saved and he's saved. I don't know. I'm not the judge. But he did begin to do some comedy without cussing, which is pretty miraculous. But he tells this one joke that I happened to hear one time. It's not a joke, it's a story. He said he was in the mall. And he was shopping for his wife. His wife asked him to go in to get something. And so he was also mentioning that white people in the South and black people are very similar. But when you get up north, he says, like, white people are a little different. And he said, especially how they discipline their kids. And how many know what I'm talking about? Discipline your kids, right? And so he says he's in the mall, and this very nice white lady comes up to him and says, "Steve Harvey, is it you? Is it you? Is it really you?" And she's all excited, and he says, "Yeah, it's me." And she says, "I want you to meet my son. If my son could meet you, it would make his world. He is such a big fan." And he said, I don't ever turn down kids, and I don't ever turn down the elderly, even if I don't want to." He says, "Okay, so I'll where is he?" She says, "Well, he's out here." And so he's thinking, "Well, I think you should bring him to me, but okay, I'll follow you out into the mall." He walks out into the mall, and he's over by a store or something. And she says, "Bobby!" And Steve Harvey says he's got a mohawk and five different colors and tattoos and piercings. And he said, "Right there, I knew there was a problem." He said, "How old is he?" And she said, 15. He said, "Not in my house."
Amen.
He said, "If you're paying rent in my house, you can have a tattoo, but you're going to get out."
Right.
Right? How many know when you're living in your, I'm just throwing this in there, by the way. If you have a house and you have kids in it, they buy by your rules until they leave the house. Can somebody say amen? Amen. Like you're going to church. Like you're gonna do what I say, not what I really, but he does a better job of it. Okay, I'm just sidetracking that for a second. So he says, "Bobby, look," and he turns and says, "Bite me," to his mama. Now, if you ever seen Steve Harvey, he was like, he froze, and so she goes, "Hold on a second," and he goes, "Don't worry, I'm holding on because I'm about to see something go down." And so she says, "Look who it is." And he says, "Mom, I said, bite me." And so when he says that again, he's looking for some place to hide, Steve Harvey. Because he knows that if his mom was there, she'd be coming in on a horse with 666 on her head and would kill everybody in the mall, Steve Harvey said. And so she says this, and the boy says that back to the mom, there's a black lady and her kid next to them. And she looks at her son and starts beating her son and says, "If you ever say that to me, if you ever," and she starts beating on the kid for what the other kid said to him. Amen. You got to see it. It's one of the funniest things you'll ever see. But how many know we got to honor and respect our mom? There's just some things you don't say to mom. Amen. Number three, understand her sympathetically. Understand her sympathetically. Our moms have worn all the hats. Let me know, God gave them a gift to wear all the hats. And a lot of times, hats they're not supposed to wear. Hats that they weren't meant to wear, but they do it all. They wear all the hats. They fill in from referee to cleaner to cooker to worker to everything. They wear all the hats to the disciplinarian sometimes, amen. And all the hats they wear. So we have to learn to understand our moms sympathetic. Number four, this is a big one. Listen to her attentively. Listen to her attentively. Some of you in here have gotten older, and the older you get, the wiser your mom gets. The older you get, the more you realize some of the things she's told you your whole life actually are true.
Right? Amen.
And actually make sense. And wouldn't it be nice if we could fast forward to be 40 or 50 or 60 and realize that what mom's telling us is actually going to save us some hell, some problems, some situations.
Yes.
Mom knows.
Yeah.
Mom knows best. Amen. And so it's a fact that as she gets older, she gets wiser, and we should listen to her. And not only listen to her, but attentive to her wisdom. Number five, this is a big one. Help her cheerfully. Help her cheerfully. Amen. That's a good place to say amen. Moms, amen. Hopefully your kids are watching this or will hear this, taking notes. Help her cheerfully. The reason I say that is because how many know we need to be reminded of all the sacrifices mom made for us? I mean, there's so many things that they taking us to the games, picking us up from school, doing our homework with us. Another funny video you got to watch. Someone shared it to the group me. You got our ministry team group me. You got to see it. It's a lady who's at home and she's at her wit's end and she's praying, and she says, "Lord, you know I'm a faithful woman, but what I'm not is a math teacher." Lord, you know I love you and everything to me, and I want to be your faithful child, but what I'm not is the cafeteria woman. And she goes on to say all these things that she's not. She finally gets to the end and she says, and Lord, if something doesn't change soon, what I am going to have is orange on me, and I am going to be an inmate. So I'm going to kill these kids. How many know that the last couple months has been that for a lot of people, right? They weren't used to being around everybody so much. Sacrifices that moms make. So we must be reminded of all the sacrifices that she has made for you in life, beginning if she didn't do anything else with bringing you into this world. Number six. This is one of my favorites. Respect her strength always. Respect her strength always. Men, I've told you for forever, and if you're a young lady and you've never had a child yet, respect a mother's strength to have a baby. Childbearing alone is enough to respect a woman. And everybody knows my take on that, amen? The world would be less babies if men had babies. There would be very, very few two-child families. China wouldn't have to do what they do to depopulate the world. Be a one and done. There would be no five or six or seven kids. You're kidding me. But women have a strength that we must respect. Especially when a woman wants to have more than one. Five, six, or like my papa, more than 15. Was it 16, 17? Somewhere around there. A whole bunch.
Too many.
And I think about the strength, and I'm going to brag on my mom when I can see her in person this morning. The strength of a woman, I think of the strength of my mother. Everybody knows the strengths that everybody has as a mother anyways, but just all the things my mom has gone through, even in the last few years. The strength that she has shown, the resiliency that she has shown in her life is something we must respect.
Yeah.
Number seven, I'm going to end with these last two. This is a good one. Remember her all the time gratefully. Remember her all the time gratefully. Be grateful. Don't focus. I'll give you some help this morning. Don't focus on the negatives. Don't focus on the things that she doesn't do good or didn't do good. Focus on the things that she's done that you're grateful for. Things that focus on some things that you can always find some things to be grateful for. And number eight, as I begin to close, remind her that she is needed. How many moms know you need to be reminded that you're needed? When a mom gets older, in her older years, and the kids are gone, and there's not so much to do anymore, it's a blessing, I'm sure, but it's also a thing where a woman can begin to think, man, I don't have a need anymore. Because moms have that thing inside of them that God puts to nurture, to take care of, to help. And when there's no grandkids around or kids around, a mom can get to a place where she feels like she's not needed. But you know what a mom has that she'll never, ever lose if she loses everything else in her life? Is the power to pray. Because there's nothing like a mama's prayer. Not that a dad can't pray, guys. Not that we have our own strengths and our own place. But there's something about a mom's prayer. I can't tell you how many people I've met in my life who knew they were saved because of a mom's prayer. I can tell you this morning, and I've said it many times in my life before, I'm in the ministry and I'm preaching the gospel because of my mom's prayers.
Amen.
Because of my mom's encouragement and speaking life into me when I didn't believe myself.
Amen.
That I was, or want to believe what I was supposed to do. So I want to end with a story that's so powerful. And it's actually a true story, even though it's going to sound made up. This might be one of the most crazy stories ever told. And this man's name is Peter Richley. And he was around living in the year 1820. Pay attention to this. Watch this. This man was a grateful man. And mostly because he had survived one of the strangest events known to mankind. Again, true story. He was traveling on a ship. Ship sunk. Then he was rescued. The rescuers came and got him out the boat. He was rescued. His life was saved. Saved, and by some strange twist of circumstance, the second ship he was in sunk. You might begin to think you've got some bad luck. He was rescued the third time. Then inside the third ship, this is a true story, that ship sunk. Yet his fourth ship of passage, as they came along to get him and he got into the ship, unbelievably sank, and he was rescued a fourth time. So after the fourth time, he began to think, sitting in that water, somebody hates me or somebody loves me, but I must not be ready to die. He gets miraculously, this is a true story, rescued for a fifth time on a fifth ship. They don't say how much time passed between all this, just that he got rescued. Now, that would have been a laughable story if it wasn't true. How many can imagine being out in the middle of the ocean and have every ship you get on sink? Somehow he floated with confidence and knew that God didn't want him to die. And as that fifth ship came to save him, he got on it and it was called the Ocean Liner from the City of Deeds. And it was named after the city of, Leeds from the British city. It was bound from England to Australia and traveled the same sea lane as all of Peter Richley's down ships. The crew of the city hoisted Peter aboard. Dry clothing was provided to meet Peter. They gave him an exam, pronounced him fit, and then they said, "We've got an unusual favor for you. There's a lady on board who booked passage to Australia," the doctor explained, "and she has been looking for her son who disappeared years ago. She's dying, and she's asking to see her son. She keeps asking over and over, 'I want to see my son again.' She knows everybody that's on board, and you're the only newcomer. They said, 'Would you do us a favor and pretend to be her son so she can feel fulfilled before she dies?" Peter agrees. He figures, hey, this must be the reason that I was saved for the fifth time, so I can help this sad mom. He follows the doctor below deck and enters into a cabin. And there on a small bed lays a frail woman with silver hair, suffering from a very high fever and deliriously crying out, "God, please let me see my son before I die. I must see my son." The ship's doctor gently pushed the young man towards the bed. And as soon as Peter looked at the woman, he began to sob. For lying on that bed was his mother. He had been estranged from her for many, many years, over 10 years. And because of the prayers of his mom, he was saved from 5 shipwrecks to get on that boat and to see his mom before she passed away.
Amen.
There is power in a praying mom. Would you bow your heads this morning? As you bow your heads, moms especially, I want you to know, if you feel like you haven't made it, you haven't done what you want to do, you haven't been the best mom you could be, and all those things the devil tries to tell a mom. She's not worthy, that she's not good enough, that she's failed, that she hasn't been the mom that she could be. I've got good news for you. That's a lie. And if there's nothing else you've done right in your world today, you can be a praying mom. A mom who can make a difference with God. There's something about a mom and her prayer life. So I want this to be an encouragement for you, mom. Even if you have been the good mom, I believe you have been. Even if you feel like you've done some good things, I want you to know God's not done with you yet. And if you don't feel like, if you ever get to that place where you feel like I can't do anything, I don't have any talents, I don't have any abilities, I don't have any resources, I don't have anybody around my life, I want you to know you can pray. You can pray. You might not even have a son or a daughter to pray for, but you can pray for me. You can pray for this church. You can pray for other family members. You can pray for revival in this world. There's something powerful about the prayer of a mom. And as your heads are bowed and eyes are closed, I want to tell you what a mom's prayer would be, number one and more important than any other prayer she'd ever pray. She'd pray that you'd be saved this morning. She'd pray that you would know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you're watching online or you're here in this service this morning and you don't know Jesus, your mom's praying for you. You might say, my mom's already gone into eternity, or my mom is not saved. She can't be praying for me. I'll tell you, a mom, some mom is praying for you this morning. There's a grandma out there crying out to God for her grandkids. There's a mom out there crying out for her brothers and her sisters and her nieces and her nephews. There's a mom who's got a direct line to God in prayer, and she's praying for your salvation this morning. How many in this place this morning, in this congregation, could say, Pastor, I've never given my life to Jesus, and today I want my life to be changed. I want to be rescued by God. Would you just lift your hand and say, Pastor, pray for me all over this place. Just put it up and put it right back down. Say, I don't know Jesus as my Lord and my Savior. Maybe you're watching online this morning. We're going to say a prayer here in just a moment. We're going to ask Jesus to come into our hearts. Everyone in this congregation is going to say this with me. You're watching right now. Somebody's praying for you. Mom's praying for you. God's doing a miracle this morning in your heart. Moms, as before I say this prayer, I want you to know one more time. You pray for your kids, and you leave them to God. Moms, you pray for your kids, and you pray for other people's kids. And other moms will pray for your kids, and we'll all pray together. Moms' prayers will be heard, and those lives will be saved, and they will come to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Let's say this sinner's prayer this morning, would you with me? Lord Jesus, I thank you for salvation. Thank you for loving me, even when I'm not lovable. Jesus, I know I'm a sinner, and I know I fall short of your glory. Would you please forgive me for all my sins? Would you rescue me this morning from eternal life without you? I'm drowning, Lord, in my sin. I'm drowning, Lord, in my shame. Forgive me. Give me a new start. I believe that you came and lived a perfect life. And I believe you died on the cross for my sins. And I believe you rose from the dead and defeated death and hell and the grave as you came out of that grave after 3 days. Jesus, would you please write my name in the Lamb's Book of Life? Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, for changing my life this morning. In Jesus' name. Amen. Would you all stand to your feet this morning? We're going to close this service with a song. We've got some homework to do. Amen. We've got plenty of room at this altar. If you come to find a place at the altar, all we ask is that you stay spread out. Keep that arm distance on both sides. But we've made extra room this morning. You want to find a place at the altar. If you want to stand over against the wall. If you want to come. Whatever you want to do. We're going to open the altars this morning. And you're welcome to stay at your seat as well. But let's just take a few minutes. Let's talk to God this morning. Let's ask God to speak to us through this message. Moms, we want you to feel honored and know that you're loved this morning. And all of us that have moms, let's say, God, help me to be that child to my mom, to honor my mother this morning. Hallelujah. Let's worship the King this morning for His goodness.
This morning.
name be glorified. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, come on, let's give him the greatest praise. Let's give him a shout of praise and thanksgiving this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Worthy is your name this morning, Jesus. You're worthy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. What makes a great mom is her relationship with Jesus. That's what helps the mom where she lacks become the super mom that she is to love Jesus. The best thing you can do for your kids is love Jesus. You can fail at everything else in the world, but if you get right loving Jesus, your kids will turn out right. That's number one. Amen. And that's what don't let them be able to say, my mom didn't love Jesus. Well, this, well, that, well, this, well, that, well, this, and that, and the other. Yeah, but she loved Jesus. If you get that right, it fixes a whole lot of problems.
Yeah.
Amen. And many of you moms here know the difference now between the you before Jesus and the you after Jesus. Amen. And we talk a lot about how, and we mentioned this on Friday, discipleship. I remember when Chris said a couple years ago from conference, he said, you wouldn't want to hang out with your old self. That's what we should remember. I don't want to be around that old person that I was. How many know, kids, that you should be thankful your mom got saved? Amen? Praise God. I personally have never known my mom not saved. Thank God. But Jesus makes the difference. Amen? So good to have done this morning. Amen. I believe we're on a track to get back to normal. We know that we may never be normal again, but the normal that we're looking for is not what the world's looking for. We're looking for what God wants. And I know that we're all believing this morning for a mighty move of God. Amen. And nothing is going to stop the church. And everything you've learned in these 2 months, good or bad, apply them. You've probably picked up some good habits. You might have picked up some bad habits during this 2 months. Keep the good habits. Get rid of the old bad ones that you might have acquired in this time. But use it to learn from it. And let's all believe. Let's all agree. Let's all pray. Let's all push forward and realize that God is on the throne this morning. Amen. He's in control of everything. Amen. Praise God. Just in case he forgets, we don't have any refreshments because we don't want to pass food and we don't want to take that risk. And that'll be indefinitely until we get different chains of information. But we do have some coffee. Somebody is going to stay for the second, so we want to get some coffee. We're serving coffee back there, so we do have some coffee. Amen? And then if you go over there, try to stay spaced out.
What an amazing word. Much needed. Amen. So awesome being here today, and oh man, it was much needed. It's so easy, we can easily fall back into our old ways, right? But thank God that he opened up the doors today for us to be here. Give the moms a big thank you again. Amen. Amazing. I know the pastor was saying about mother's prayers. That's the reason why I'm here today, because of her. And just knowing, you know, me battling through my addictions and all the pain that I've heard through, but knowing that those prayers were heard and they were answered for her. And I was going to tell her that I love her. I know she's listening this morning. I'm going to tell her that I love her. And let's give the Lord a big shout and a big thank you. Amen. Give them all the praise. Come on, church. We got more than that. Amen. It's been too long. Amen. Oh, God, we thank you, Father, for this day, Jesus. Oh, God, you are mighty and worthy to be praised, Father. Oh, God, we thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Be dismissed. Let's all pray together. Amen. Oh, dear gracious Father, we thank you so much for this awesome word today, Father. For all the mothers out there, Father, just thanking you, Father, for just allow them to listen to this word, Father. Take it with them, Father, and allowing us to be, you know, as children to be better, Father, to be better children to them, Father. Just to thank them, Father, for all that they have done in our lives, Lord. And God, we thank you for allowing us to open up, to be here today and to open up the doors for us, Father. God, we thank you for all that you do. We pray for your protection upon us as we walk out, that you'll continue to use us to be your light, Father. Almighty God, we thank you, Father. We praise you, Father. We give you all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. In the powerful, mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray. And we all said, amen.